I am asking a very straight question. This is where Mr. Isaac has been successful. I would say that it is absolutely ridiculous. Economically, financially, it will be suffocating for the state to move forward. In the parliamentary politics, a generation change need to happen.
Today we have with us Sri Mathew Kuzhalnadan, KPCC General Secretary. Welcome, Mathew.
Yeah, welcome. Thank you.
You are a KPCC General Secretary and a very prominent face of the new generation Congress leaders in Kerala. Apart from that, what is your connection with RSS and the BJP?
The last 2-3 days, now that is so many people are also asking, is there anything like that? Because I mean, the respected finance minister himself has come on record saying that there is a conspiracy. He has alleged a conspiracy theory in connection with a writ petition which has been filed in the High Court of Kerala. But I would say that it is absolutely ridiculous. I mean, I had read about RSS. I had seen RSS programs, I had seen RSS leaders. Often I used to participate in some TV discussions along with them. Beyond that, in my lifetime, I had no association, even no friends from RSS BJP background. That is the truth.
But in the Kerala High Court, you are representing Mr. Ranjit, who himself is an RSS supporter. He represents Sudeshi Jagran Manja, Sangabariwara outfit. Isn't it itself an evidence for this? You are obviously with the RSS.
It's true that I am representing a matter wherein this Ranjit Karthikeyan is the petitioner. That is true. But at the time when I took up the brief or took the file, he was a chartered accountant. And all that I know is that he is a chartered accountant and he is having reasonable knowledge about this finance and economy and all. And he is also a public-spirited person who want to take up issues related to the financial domain. So that's all the understanding was. And as a lawyer, that is more than sufficient to know about a client. We don't look at clients, religion, caste, his political affiliation. Everything is immaterial. I manage, politics and profession as two different streams. And it's also very tough to do the same, but at the same time, I have stated this earlier also. My approach to politics is that, someone should work to earn and politics should be service. So as a lawyer, I am perfectly justified in taking up a brief, but it's only a couple of days back, I came to know that this particular client or the petitioner has got a background of RSS he's an office bearer of Sudeshi Jagran Manch. This is the fact.
But then the finance minister, Mr. Thomas Isaac, has made some serious allegations against you. He is saying this entire case against KIIFB is a conspiracy that was hatched in Delhi. What is the truth actually?
Yeah, beyond that statement, being a minister, being a senior leader of the CPM, he has not even produced an iota of evidence to prove what he has stated. Apart from his statement, there is nothing. It is vacuum, it is hollow. And he made such an allegation in the air and it vanished in the thin air. That's what I think, because he could not substantiate or he could not. There is no evidence, there is nothing like that. So it's up to him to prove, or it's up to him to come up with some solid evidence to support what he said.
As far as we understand, now the finance minister himself is saying that some portions were added in the CAG report without consulting the state government, and you're raising the same allegations in the case. So can we blame people if they doubt that there is it was all planned?
No, in fact, what I feel very sorry for, the finance minister, he is in a stage where he is caught red-handed because, last 3 days he, on air or on record, he stated many times that he was referring to the draft report sent by the CAG, and now it has come quite clear or now it has come open, that there is no such draft report, there is no reference to reference of this point in the draft report, and it was the final report which he was referring to. So now, to just avoid the embarrassment, he is making all this bald allegations, I mean all this statements, and nothing more than that. It is true that we have raised this issue long back when this the issuance of masala bond was discussed. I personally, when participating in such a channel discussion, TV discussion, I had flagged this issue, that whether it would be constitutional for the state to provide sovereign guarantee outside the territory of India. But at that point of time, in fact, no one took it seriously. KIIFB went ahead with the issuance and providing of the sovereign guarantee. And subsequently, we filed the petition in February. And that is pending in the High Court since that several months. But now, the CAG is also a party to that petition. That is true. But now it is understood that now in the CAG's report, in the final report, they have also referred to this point, stating that it is unconstitutional to provide sovereign guarantee outside and raise money outside the territory of India. So I think now that is what is worrying Mr. Isaac, because apart from this, there is lot many other allegations going to come up, and lot many things to be unraveled with respect to the functioning of the KIIFB, and especially with respect to the finance ministry. That is worrying him.
Many people, including those who follow public finance keenly, they say that KIIFB was some sort of a revolutionary movement, because the Kerala is a state that faces deep financial crunch. Our resources are very limited, and don't you think that KIIFB was the only option, or KIIFB is the only option for a state like us to find funds for our infrastructure development or the holistic development of the state?
This is where Mr. Isaac has been successful, because he has created such an impression that KIIFB is the panacea for all the problems Kerala is facing, and without KIIFB, Kerala cannot survive. This was the very same argument the LDF government, the chief minister and the senior ministers put up when the sprinkler controversy came up. Without sprinkler, we cannot fight COVID. Without sprinkler, Kerala cannot survive. This was the approach, this was the attitude, this was the statement. The same with KIIFB. I mean, I would say KIIFB is nothing but, I mean, an instrument which is going to put Kerala in deep financial crisis, deep financial trouble. Over the years, I mean, from 2023 onwards, I mean, it will be economically, financially, it will be suffocating for the state to move forward. So that's I absolutely deny, or I would say it is rubbish to say that KIIFB is the only option for the state of Kerala to move forward.
But then the finance minister keeps saying that the liabilities of KIIFB will never exceed the assets. Then what is the problem? Why do you think that it will put the state in deep trouble in the future?
No, I would say in a one-line answer to that, every rupee borrowed or taken by KIIFB is guaranteed by the state against the consolidated fund or against the state exchequer. So every money raised and spent by KIIFB is the liability of state government. Then how can he say that, I mean, it's not going to affect the state or people of Kerala? No, KIIFB don't have any independent existence. KIIFB has not raised, or KIIFB has not created any money or profit so far. Then how could he say that, I mean, it's not going to affect Kerala? Absolutely ridiculous statement.
But then how do you look at these so-called development projects that are taking place in the state?
No, the development projects, I mean, is executed through KIIFB for the convenience of certain interest in the government or interest in the CPM party. Nothing more than that. Because earlier PWD was doing the same. So what is the fund in routing the money through somebody else and saying that that particular body is the only option or only answer to whole question of development? No, it's not like that. State exchequer's money is being routed through KIIFB. What sense it makes? Nothing. Earlier we had, PWD functioning in one domain, water authority functioning in another domain, or other roads and bridges corporation in another domain. So, I mean, the entire funding they decided to route it through KIIFB, and I don't see any major advancement or any major efficiency or any major change in the overall efficiency of the administration after bringing this KIIFB into place.
Are you saying that this entire thing should be stopped?
No, that's not my point. I am asking a very straight question. Whether the state has provided sovereign guarantee for the masala bonds outside the territory of India, number one. If it has done, it is unconstitutional. That's what my point. If they haven't provided sovereign guarantee, then well enough, there is no case against on that point. Number two, the claim of the government and especially the finance minister is that the KIIFB is functioning so transparently, KIIFB is functioning without corruption, KIIFB is functioning with high efficiency, and KIIFB is so transparent, all this stuff. Then why are you opposing audit under section 20 of CNAG audit? What is the problem? Why you are afraid? Why you are denying? Why you are resisting a proper audit by CNAG? These are the only two questions against KIIFB. And we don't say that the KIIFB assets to be dumped we need to do away with the KIIFB. That's not the case.
This entire controversy is happening only a few months before the state elections. And, if the UDF comes to power in 2021, what will be the fronts or what will be that government's approach to KIIFB?
One thing I can tell you, if Congress comes to power, we are not going to allow or continue with the KIIFB in the present shape and the present mode, and we are not going to approve the present modalities of the functioning of KIIFB. That doesn't mean that we are going to do away with the KIIFB as such, because I mean there would be obligations already created which any continuing government will have to uphold. Or we cannot shoulder out the responsibilities. But I would say that we won't be going ahead with the KIIFB in the present mode.
What kind of changes can we expect in such a scenario?
Now, Kerala requires, I mean, groundbreaking revolutionary reforms to survive. Not to excel, I am saying, to survive. Because, I mean, we are in deep financial crisis as on today. And total debt ratio of state is very alarming, and there is a huge pressure, stress, financial stress, for which I mean the state needs to take a different path of approach. Congress will definitely look at the financial approach from a totally different angle. We have a different view, we have a different approach, and we have a totally different plan of action to address the situation.
It sounds a very general statement.
Yeah, the more detailing has to come in. I mean, I hope you will get a more clear idea when we are coming up with the manifesto. Okay. Because we will be more focusing on revenue generation rather than depending on this fundraising alone. We will be more focusing on revenue generation and revenue distribution, and also efficiency of the administration and to save the expenditure. So that will be the twin approach Congress would be adopting to improve the state finance.
If all these things have to happen, the UDF has to be in power next year. How do you look at the current political situation?
We are quite confident that the people of Kerala is going to throw away this LDF government the very first opportunity that they get. So, UDF is very confident of coming back to power, and we will have an impressive victory in the coming elections.
See, the campaigning for local body elections are already on, and recently you wrote an open letter to KPCC chief Ullappally Ramachandran seeking some sweeping changes in the party's approach towards selecting candidates and all. What happened to that letter?
I am advocating a generation change in Congress in every level. in the sense, I mean, inside the party, inside the organization, and also in the parliamentary politics, generation change need to happen. For that, I mean, there should be some approach to implement the same. So one such idea or one such proposal I suggested is that those who are contested continuously for 3 times should not be allowed to contest for the 4th time continuously, at least in the this local body elections. So that way it will give opportunities for youngsters, or it will give opportunity for new faces. So that proposal I sent to the PCC president. So after that, PCC president reacted to that in a different way. That's something different. Of course, he is a senior, he is the PCC president, he can do that. But later we discussed, and he also appreciated, or he understood our concern, and he said, I mean, that point is well noted, but I mean, he had only, his reservation was only that was in public, that could be avoided. So I also accepted the same. So that way the controversy has died down. So I think you should not dig it further.
No, but candidate selection is going on across the state. Do you think that your suggestions are being implemented?
I would say Congress leadership has taken earnest efforts to bring change in the prevailing approach or attitude of candidate selection. But I from a point of view of an younger generation, I would say it cannot be said to be to the level of our satisfaction. It's not up to a satisfactory level or desirable level, but still there was an effort which should be definitely appreciated.
Some political analysts or political observers say that this upcoming state polls will be a do or die battle for the Congress, because it will be, if despite all these favorable conditions, if the UDF can't make it to power this time, some observers say that it will be the end of the party or the front in the state, because the BJP will take over the opposition space. Do you agree? Do you have such fears?
I would say we are confident of winning the elections, number one. But I am not ruling out that overconfidence or any lazy approach can be of heavy cost for Congress. So Congress also need to be very vigilant, very hardworking, very determined in the state of Kerala. We cannot take things for granted, that's for sure. I am of the firm view that any overconfidence or any lackadaisical approach may prove costly for party later. So we need to be very hard working.
Does the Congress have to be afraid of BJP in Kerala?
No, it's not the matter of being afraid, but we should also be well aware of the fact that it's no more that two political forces in the state, a third force, especially a communal force, a poisonous force, is trying to enter, or already they have entered and trying to grab their space in the state of Kerala. So we need to be vigilant. We need not be afraid, but we need to be vigilant.
Okay, maybe to conclude, let's come back to KIIFB, or where we started once again. Now with all these controversies, it's a raging controversy, not only in the state, but across the country. What is going to happen with KIIFB now?
KIIFB, as such, I mean, immediately, I don't think there is some big changes going to happen. But if the since the matter is pending before the court, it may not be appropriate for me as a lawyer to comment on that. But when the legality of the KIIFB's action is being tested, or the constitutionality of the action is being tested, and if anything adverse comes up, then I mean that may have serious ramifications in the future of KIIFB. That's what I would say at this point of time.
Can we call the current case, which is pending before the court, the death knell of KIIFB?
No. I don't want to put it that way. But we have raised a constitutional question. We are waiting to see what would be the outcome. That's all.
Okay, anyway, let's wait for the best outcome that will be in the best interest of the state.
Of course, all the people of Kerala.
Thank you
thank you so much.